On January 28, 1896, 22-year-old Sunday school teacher Pearl Bryan told her parents she was leaving her home in Greencastle, Indiana, to visit a friend in Indianapolis. Instead, Bryan headed to Cincinnati to see a man she had been seeing. A week later, Bryan's headless body was found more than 150 miles away in Fort Thomas, Kentucky, just behind what is now a YMCA. Her head had been cut off and was not with the body. At the time, Bryan was 5 months pregnant, which was unknown to her family. Two students at the Ohio College of Dental Surgery in nearby Cincinnati were soon arrested for the murder. Scott Jackson, one of the two students, had been romantically involved with Bryan for several months in secret leading up to her death. According to testimony offered during their trial, he had convinced his roommate, Alonzo Walling, to help him. The two had slipped cocaine into Bryan's drink while at a saloon, then murdered her by cutting off her head to avoid proper identification. However, this did not work. Detectives identified her body in just a matter of hours. A serial number on her shoe identified the manufacturer, which led them to the store in Greencastle that sold the shoes. The size revealed they belonged to Bryan, the daughter of a socially prominent farmer living just south of Greencastle. Nobody can say for sure what the men did with her head after cutting it off because they gave conflicting statements. One claimed the head was buried in a Kentucky sandbar, the other claimed it was at the bottom of the Ohio River. A bartender at the saloon told police he remembered Jackson and Walling giving him a bag to place behind the bar on the night of Bryan's disappearance. He noted something inside rolled back and forth like a bowling ball. The men returned 15 minutes later, retrieved the bag, left the saloon, and returned the bag to the bartender. This time the bag felt empty, he said. Police suspected Jackson and Walling had enough time to walk to the nearby dental college, throw the head into a college furnace, and return to the saloon. The bag, as it turns out, was Bryan's red valise. The autopsy revealed that Bryan was murdered at the spot where her body was found. Her head had been severed with a dissecting knife. Due to the amount of blood at the scene, the doctor who examined her body suspected that her heart was beating when she was beheaded. The nearby waterways and canals were drained in search of her head. However, it was never found and remains missing as of this recording. The brutal nature of the crime attracted considerable media attention at the time. The trial of the two killers was called the Trial of the Century, and witness accounts described the courtroom as theatrical. People came from miles around to view the crime scene. Some even went so far as to take souvenirs, such as branches taken from around the area where the body was located. There is even speculation that some of those branches may have been splashed with the victim's blood. A store near the courthouse even sold Pearl Bryan memorabilia and other merchandise related to the crime. Both men were quickly found guilty and sentenced to death by hanging. According to the newspaper accounts, the announcement of the verdict was accompanied by a large force of armed officers in citizens' clothing, ready and waiting for any mob violence that might break out. At that time, the likelihood of a public lynching in a case so notorious and widely publicized was a genuine danger. According to an article published in the Dayton Daily News, there was a jailbreak not long after the men received their sentence. After hearing the news, a large mob rushed the jail but immediately dispersed when they heard that Jackson and Walling were still behind bars. The two killers had been unwilling to join their fellow convicts in their escape because they knew the jail was the safest place for them. On March 20, 1897, the two men were hanged behind the Newport Campbell County Courthouse on York Street. Walling went to the gallows protesting that he was not to blame for the crime. At the same time, when given a last-minute opportunity to stay Walling's execution with his testimony, Jackson declared that he could not truthfully say that Walling was innocent. Both men were hanged simultaneously. According to reports, neither of their necks broke, each one strangled to death. They were the last people hanged in Newport. The gallows located behind the courthouse were torn down following the execution. The story of Pearl Bryan and her missing head did not end there. Within a couple of decades of the crime, popular folk songs began to appear, detailing it and further speculating on it, with the earliest recording by American country singer Vernon Dalhart in 1926. Among these speculations is the claim that the headless ghost of Pearl Bryan haunts Bobby Mackey's music world, which is also said to be one of several gateways to hell. The connection between Bryan and the nightclub exists simply because her body was found just over 2 miles away from its location. Legends have also sprung up over the years to suggest that Bryan's killers might have been Satanists who cursed the ground on which the nightclub stands, vowing to haunt those involved in the case. Like most of the stories surrounding Bobby Mackey's music world, there is little to corroborate them. Nothing in the trials of either Jackson or Walling suggests occult or ritualistic motivations behind their actions. Bryan's pregnancy was the far more likely motive. According to that same report in the Dayton Daily News, Walling testified that Jackson told him of Pearl Bryan's condition and asked him to relieve her by a criminal operation. Other ideas for Pearl included a plan to poison her and make it look like a suicide. The truth of what happened on that tragic night is shrouded in mystery. All that is known is it left trees along the roadside dripping with blood and Bryan's headless corpse leaning against the fence. As to what became of Bryan's missing head, it is a secret that both men took to their graves. In an emotionless voice, just before he was hanged, Walling said, "I will tell you now, in the last moment of my life, I was not there, and I am innocent of the whole crime. I cannot say any more." Bryan is buried in Forest Hill Cemetery in Greencastle, Indiana. Visitors on the grave often place pennies heads up on the headstone to provide Pearl with a head.